Welcome, welcome to Girl Power. Welcome to Girl Power. We're so excited to have you all here. Girl Power is presented by Toledo Edison, a First Energy company. We're so excited to have Katie Sowers here as our keynote speaker. But before we get started, we want to hear from you. So on your screen, a poll should pop up and you'll see some names on it. These are probably names that you're not familiar with. These are some amazing women that have done work in the STEM field. And we have some awesome names, and I want you to pick your favorite one. So there's a brief description after each woman. We have Ada Lovelace, and she was considered one of the first computer programmers. Her father was actually Lord Byron, and her mom thought he left the family when she was very young. Her mom thought that was not the way her daughter should go and really focused her in on the study of mathematics. Henrietta Swan Leavitt. Now, she was an astronomer who discovered over 2,400 stars, which is just incredible. And her research actually led to Edwin Hubble's understanding that the universe is expanding. Alice Ball was an absolute genius in chemistry. And there was a horrible disfiguring disease called leprosy that she helped find the cure for. She was also one of the first female professors in the United States. Beatrice Schilling, this woman is one of my favorites. She's an aeronautical engineer, and she was also a daredevil motorcyclist. And during World War II, over in England, they were finding that their fighter planes were stalling, which is not a good thing. And she found a stopgap solution, a temporary solution to help those planes. And her work is actually attributed with helping the Allies win the war. And then the last name there might be familiar to you. That's Katherine Johnson. And she is an amazing mathematician. She did her work with NASA. She was featured in the movie Hidden Figures. And her work was so trusted that when Ohio astronaut John Glenn was ready to go into space, in one of his missions, he'd started using computers. And he said, the computer's fine, but have Katherine check those numbers before you send me up there. So a list of, you know, five extraordinary women there. If you could get your votes in, I'll give you a few more moments. All right, and I think we can end the poll. And before we go any further, we need to thank our sponsors today. Our sponsors make this event possible. We would not be able to host our Girl Power event without their wonderful support. We have our presenting sponsor, which is Toledo Edison and First Energy Foundation. We have our innovator sponsor, which is Comfort Line Fiber Frame. We're also thankful for our pioneer sponsors, OI and SSOE, our catalyst sponsors, Columbia Gas, Buckeye Broadband, and the Collaborative. And lastly, our explorers, which are the Andersons, Lathrop, and Labe Electric Technology. So thank you for all your support. And our poll results are in. Katherine Johnson was the most voted woman. She's also the most recognizable name on that list. But I think we can all agree that list of women was absolutely extraordinary. And a lot of you, when you registered today, you were asked a question. You were asked to describe someone who works in STEM using three words. And so the word cloud that you see there is a representation of the most frequent responses. So the bigger the word is there, the more often that we saw that response. And I absolutely love the words that we see here. We see words like creative and smart and curious and intelligent, fun, cool, helpful, innovative. Now, the women in the poll certainly possessed all those qualities. And the two women that you're going to hear today, both the woman I'm about to introduce and then Katie herself, also certainly possess all of these characteristics as well. Now, I am going to introduce Meg Adams here, but before I do so, I just want to make you aware of a feature that you have here on Zoom. If you look at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a Q&A option. If you click on that, that's where you can ask your questions, because after Katie speaks today, you're going to have an opportunity to get some of your questions answered. So if you want to type in a question that you're thinking about as Katie's presenting, please do so. If you see a question in that Q&A that you think is a great question, it's your question too, there's a little thumbs up option. If you thumbs it up, that's going to send that question up to the top and you'll have a greater chance of getting it answered, because unfortunately we only have so much time. I'm sure everyone's questions won't be answered today. All right. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Meg Adams. She's the Regional External Affairs Manager at Toledo Edison, a First Energy company. And Meg is one of three managers responsible for local community and government relations throughout the Toledo Edison Company's service territory. She's involved with local chambers of commerce, school districts, and nonprofit groups, acting as the first line of contact for information about community resources, contributions, programs, and activities. Now, Meg started her career as a computer programmer. So if she had to vote today, I'm going to guess she'd vote for Ada Lovelace. After graduating from Bowling Green State University with a Bachelor of Science in Business Administration, majoring in Management Information Systems. And Meg lives here in Toledo with her husband, Steve, and she has not one, but two millennial children as well. She's a proud mother. So without further ado, Meg Adams.
Thank you, Sloan. Toledo Edison, a First Energy company, and the First Energy Foundation are proud to support Girl Power because it aligns perfectly with our educational, workforce development, and diversity and inclusion goals. We believe it's critical to foster a diverse pool of science and engineering professionals to meet our company's workforce requirements into the future, and we're not alone. That's why it's so important Toledo Edison and the First Energy Foundation supports initiatives across our service territory just like this. It is my honor today to introduce this year's keynote speaker to all of you. Katie Sowers is just the second woman to hold a full-time coaching position in the NFL and the first openly gay coach in the league. She just wrapped up her fourth season, most recently working as an offensive assistant for the San Francisco 49ers. Off the field, Katie knows her science. She has a master's degree in kinesiology, which means that she uses a lot of science to prevent and manage different injuries and conditions that restrict movement in the body, knowledge that comes in handy working with athletes. Along with her long list of accomplishments and accolades, including being listed as one of the 100 most influential women in sports by Sport 360, Katie also competed at the highest level of women's tackle football, playing in the Women's Football Alliance for 8 years, and was selected as a member of the United States Women's National Football Team in 2013. We are so excited to have her here with us today to talk about her journey to the NFL sidelines. Everyone, please welcome Katie Sowers.
Well, thank you guys for allowing me to speak to you all. You know, as I was thinking about everything that I wanted to say to you guys, I was first of all amazed as I'm listening, just everything that you guys are offering. And I'm, you know, anyone who's listening, you guys are being provided something amazing. And this is, you know, a critical moment in our history. So thank you all. And thanks to everyone who's listening. And hopefully, you know, my story, I like to tell stories and so you can get an idea of kind of where I came from and how I got to where I am, and use that as a tool to hopefully inspire you with, you know, what's next in your journey. You know, so when I'm looking at all of this next generation of young girls, and, you know, how do I inspire you to become, you know, the engineers, the innovators, the pioneers? Thinking about all of that led me to this foundation of what I believe opens the door to critical self-discovery. And it brings out the best in people. It's this foundation of our success, and it's finding your why. And if anyone's heard me speak before, I think this is the number one indicator of if you will be successful later in life, is if you can find your why. It's definitely easier said than done, but I believe each and every person has an opportunity to find their why. Many times, though, the door to this opportunity is difficult to see. We grow up in a world labeled by pink and blue. You know, this is for you and that is for me. But what if your passion and why is actually what you grew up thinking was something made for people that's not like you? This can make that passion hard to even discover. The reality is that we are all striving to create the best version of ourselves and make a difference in this world while chasing our dreams. I'm here to tell you it's definitely difficult to chase a dream that you have never even imagined or seen. In order to inspire the younger generations, I want to start by first helping to create a societal shift in the way that we view the world, a shift that is no longer divided by invisible barriers, but a world open to opportunity. And it starts with you all. I want to start out by sharing a little bit about my story, how I got to where I am, and as I said before, hopefully give you an idea as to how I came up with what I found to be key factors that led me to my own passion and success. And, you know, that I once believed was never an opportunity for people like me. Oftentimes we believe that trailblazers are only people that we hear about on the news, but each and every person has the ability to blaze their own trail. My path was definitely not easy, and I felt lost probably more than you can believe, but I always knew it was my path. And I wanted to share with you guys a journal entry that I wrote over 10 years ago. And I have it with me here, and this is real. I did type it out. I didn't type it on paper, but this is really what I wrote when I was 24 years old. It tells you how old I am now. But this is what it said. Dear Katie, how are you? What are you doing with life? I know it won't be years until you read this, but I want you to know that I'm at a crossroads in life. I'm struggling to find my way, but I'm hoping that as you read this, you will smile knowing that all this struggle was worth the pain. I'm lying in bed thinking about a future I long to have. Please tell me you are happy. There is nothing better than pure happiness. Promise me that if you haven't found happiness, you will go out and find it for yourself. Good luck with everything you do in this life. Love, Katie. So I often go back and reflect on these journal entries. And if you guys don't write in journals, I really suggest that you do, because it gives you a great perspective on life. And it'll, you know, for me, it allows me to reflect on my story that is probably even more similar to your story than you even know. That there's success, there's failure. It happens to all of us. So when I'm talking to you guys as this next generation, embrace this incredible part of your story. Every challenge is a turning point in your life. It's a stepping stone to tomorrow. And it's a reminder that nothing in life is guaranteed, but it is that reality that can make each moment that much more beautiful. Throughout my life experience, I have 5 pieces of advice. It's very coach-like to have a list of advice, but I believe these are game changers in the way we view society and the way we view ourselves as we search for our own why. I would love for you guys to take these ideas with you as you continue your own journey to finding your why and impacting the world with your unique gifts and talents. Advice to help you find your own happiness, just as in my letter showed, I was searching for my own. So my first piece of advice is your attitude will be the difference. If there's one thing that we all share, it's that we've felt the burden of hardship that life can throw at us, especially during this past year. And in a world that separates us and at times holds us down, I'm here to tell you that it's not the weight of the world that determines how much you can accomplish. It's the way in which you view that weight. Do you allow the weight of the world to weigh you down, or do you use it as fuel to make you stronger? One of the greatest lessons I learned in this life is that our attitude will dictate our narrative and the way in which we view our lives. I love this quote from the book, The Happiness Advantage. And it says, reality is merely our brain's relative understanding of the world based on where and how we are observing it. I had a player once that spoke to our team and had us reflect on this statement. He said, if you lost everything you had today, the people you love, your ability to walk or talk, your job, your friends, but you gained it all back tomorrow, I guarantee that tomorrow would be the best day of your life. So as you think about that situation, what changed from before you lost everything to after you gained it all back? Really, the only thing that changed was the way in which you viewed what it was that you had. I saw a real life example of how our attitude can change our view of reality after my dad had a massive stroke on Memorial Day weekend over 2 years ago. I had some time off work, so I decided to use that time to travel home see my family. My parents were driving up to Kansas City. They were about 3 hours away from living in the small town that I grew up in. My dad was a stud athlete and he won a golf tournament that morning and then drove 3 hours with my mom to spend time with all of us. And we were just enjoying our day, spending time out by the pool. We had a nice dinner. We had some pizza, salad. And all of a sudden I noticed my dad was acting strange and he seemed disoriented and he was having trouble seeing out of one of his eyes. And I made the decision to take him to the ER just to be safe. And what we found that he was having a minor stroke that would then later become a massive stroke. And it would take away his ability to walk and talk. Little did we know that although my dad survived the stroke at the time, it would later lead to his death 2 years later, and he would never make the trip back to the little town of Heston, where I grew up. My parents' short trip to Kansas City ended up being permanent. My mom was presented with difficulties that no one could have ever been prepared for. She not only had to deal with the grief of watching her husband of 50 years struggle to survive, but she had to make the tough decision to sell what they thought would be their forever home in order to be around her daughters so that we could help care for my dad. She knew this was a battle that she couldn't handle alone. And for months, my family adapted to this new way of life. There were many times I felt as though quality of life could never return for any of us. I remember one trip home, I could tell that the stress and grief was starting to weigh on my mom. I ended up taking my mom to the doctor because everything just seemed to be falling apart and she became physically ill because of it. And for once in my life, I saw my hero, my mom, reach out for help. And the next time I was able to visit my family because I was living in California at the time, I saw a huge difference in her attitude. She'd somehow regained her happiness. I remember asking her what changed. And she told me that she began to think of her situation differently and life changed. She attacked the reality of her life with the mindset that I do not have to take care of my husband. I get to take care of my husband. This simple change in her perspective helped me to see that happiness is not just a feeling, but more so it's a work ethic. It's a mindset. It's an attitude. So as you continue your path, I challenge you to wake up each morning with an attitude of I get to rather than I have to. Believe me, this attitude will greatly impact your own happiness as well as the joy of all of those around you that have the privilege of working with you. And you will definitely see the world through a different lens. Now, my piece of advice number two is it seems silly, but it's don't assume she likes pink. As I mentioned earlier, we live in a world full of pink and blue. And I don't think I have to explain, but I will. I'm not just referring to girls and the color pink. I'm talking about all the invisible barriers that we knowingly and unknowingly place on the people due to gender, race, religion, sexual orientation, whatever it might be. No matter how open-minded you believe that you are, we all have been influenced by the societal norm. This world is full of stereotypes. You have been and will continue to be influenced by this reality. For me, growing up, football was my favorite sport. I remember coming home from school every day and playing football with my twin sister. Every Sunday, we would look forward to the time where we would create a list of every kid in the neighborhood that might want to play. And we would go down the list, calling them each one by one and asking if they wanted to come play football with us. I will say that many would leave the game crying because I had a unique style of tackling where I would actually grab them by the t-shirt and spin them around, throw them down. So some of them did turn to actually just asking to be a ref for the game. And we were okay with that. But I still vividly remember the day when I realized that those very same boys that I taught to throw football came home with a school football jersey. I can still see them holding up that jersey, smiling ear to ear, knowing they no longer had to just play in the backyard. They had made it on a real team. That opportunity for me seemed impossible. It felt unfair. I had never seen a girl play football. on a real team, and I had never even considered that to be an option. Now, if I would have allowed this societal norm, this stereotype, this invisible barrier to limit my future, I would not be here today speaking to you. Looking back, I had no idea that the words unconscious bias was limiting my opportunities. Have you ever walked through a store and thought about the toy aisles as a boy aisle or a girl aisle? I'm sure many of you have, at least at some point. One Christmas, I went shopping with my niece, Clara, and told her that she could pick out any toy she wanted. We walked through each aisle at the toy department, and I mean, it was every aisle was not good enough. And she couldn't seem to find anything that she wanted. She's a little weird when it comes to toys, and she really wants something specific, but we could not find anything. And we went to an aisle, and she said, we're going to skip that aisle. That's a boy aisle. And I kind of looked at her, said, okay. So we continued walking. She still couldn't find anything. I said, how about, let's try this. Let's go back to the aisle that you referred to as a boy aisle, and let's just see what they have. She finally agreed and quickly found a really cool Lego set that she loved. A couple of years later, that same niece, Clara, was out with my sister. They drove by a football field, and there were a bunch of little kids playing football. And my sister pointed out one of the little boys on the field, and my niece stopped her mid-sentence and said, boys don't play football. What I realized was that my niece had only been exposed to women playing football from a very young age. Going to her aunt's football games every Saturday, never once had she seen a boy play the game. My sister had to explain to her that both boys and girls can play football. Now I'm talking about a niece that is your stereotypical wears pink, hates football type of girl. And she still had this idea that only girls played football. This comment alone validated the impact that we unknowingly have on ourselves and our children by what we expose them to. We can change the view of the world's reality by the things we choose and do not choose to show them. My niece saw football as a girl's game because that was all she'd ever been exposed to. When we think of life in terms of store aisles, think of how many opportunities we are missing out on because we have somehow created an environment that limits our perspective. With this piece of advice, I urge you to break down the invisible barriers that limit our communities. Be open and accepting of the differences that you come across, and know that it's these differences that will make us stronger. Here's number three, words of advice number three. If it doesn't open, it may not be your door. So I'm a strong believer in the fact that I am where I am in my life because of a lot of stuff that didn't go my way. It didn't go quite as I had planned. Now, remember, when you encounter times that do not go as you planned, know that this was your plan. When I was in college, I felt like it was time to open up about who I was and my sexuality. And I stopped hiding the reality that I was gay. For the most part, everyone was extremely accepting and supportive. For the first time, I got to where I really felt like I knew my place in the world. I was open about who I was. My career path seemed to be clear to me because coaching was always something I knew I wanted to do, following in my dad's footsteps. The sport I thought I was going to coach was actually basketball, because not only was my dad a basketball coach, but my experience was limited to playing backyard football with the boys. Having served as a captain for my basketball team, it was a natural transition to continue my leadership qualities and knowledge of the game during my, what I call a victory lap in college, my fifth year. And I noticed that the team that I had been a part of was in need of some assistance. Now, this was, at the time, it was a small private Christian school that didn't have a lot of money for athletics and did not even allow professors at the school to be openly gay. And I decided I'd reach out to my former basketball coach to see if I could help out with anything with the team as a volunteer assistant serving in really any capacity that was needed. And, you know, I thought this would be a huge help for them and for me in building my resume. And everything just seemed to be falling into place. But my coach emailed me and asked to speak to me privately, and I knew something was wrong. He proceeded to tell me that because of my lifestyle as an open lesbian, he did not want me around the team. At this point in my college career, it felt like I was at a block in the road. I felt like there was nothing I could do. I remember leaving his office feeling like everything I had envisioned about my life was crumbling to the ground. For weeks, I felt hurt and defeated. I remember being so angry. I was angry at my former coach who had put me in leadership positions when I was his player, and he was so quick to dismiss me the moment I was no longer his player. It was extremely easy to feel sorry for myself, and I took some time to feel sorry for myself. But one day I was sitting in my room and I made the decision that I had to move on, control the controllables. I began browsing the internet and stumbled upon a women's tackle football league. My childhood memories and my love for football, they came flooding back to me, and I quickly began to search for a team in the area, and I found a team actually an hour and 15 minutes away in Michigan. And I made the decision to play, and I never looked back. As I think about the discrimination that I encountered, I now see that situation as a blessing in disguise. If one door doesn't open, it may not be your door. What I once thought was my door was in fact locked because there was another door waiting for me. Now, whether you believe in the idea that things happen for a reason or not, the truth is life will not work out the way in which you envisioned it. And that's okay. It took me a while, but I had to find a way to continue on with my life on a path least expected. And it ended up being my path. If it wasn't for being turned down, I would not be where I am. You will fail and you will encounter unexpected times, but these times are a part of your story, and your story is far from over. Which leads me to words of advice number 4. Hatred will not cure ignorance. Now, I'm not gonna lie, I felt a lot of hatred in my heart after being told I was not wanted around the team because of who I was. But what I grew to learn was that hatred and judgment will not cure ignorance. I'm going to repeat that. Hatred and judgment will not cure ignorance. The only thing that can cure ignorance, in my opinion, is communication and education. When we're quick to anger, we lose all ability to authentically communicate with those who need it the most. By simply allowing people to be who they are, and allowing yourself to be who you are, you allow people to see the authentic you. And the more authentic you can be, and the more you seek to be the best version of yourself, regardless of what others might think, the more you will see that those around you start to change in a positive way. I will always remember a story my grandma used to tell me about her son, who was my uncle, who was born with Down syndrome back in the 1950s. And I don't know if you guys know this, but at that time, there was not a lot of knowledge and understanding about people with disabilities in the schools or the churches or in society. When it was time for child dedication at the church my grandmother attended, she was told that my 17-month-old uncle, as weird as that sounds, David, could not be dedicated. Because the scripture said that we should not bring a blemished lamb to the altar. With Down syndrome, David was considered blemished. On Sunday morning, as all the other children went out to the front of the church with their parents, my grandmother sat in the back row holding David. Tears were falling down her face as she watched the other perfect children become dedicated, and her tears lightly fell on David's face. As I did, David looked up at my grandma and smiled. A pastor years later shared a new way of thinking about this event, saying that my grandmother dedicated her child in the most profound way that a mother could, by dedicating David with her own tears. Now, I have no doubt that life will feel unfair at times, as I'm sure they do right now, with everything that's going on in the world. And there will be times when the ignorance in this world can feel overwhelming. But when you find yourself with tears in your eyes because the world feels so unfair, allow those tears to propel you forward. Those tears could very well be a symbol of a better tomorrow. And my final words of advice for you are simple. Believe in yourself and those you meet along the way. To all of you young girls out there seeking to do more and be more, know that we all have this unlocked potential that is just waiting to be pulled out. All too often we get stuck in this self-doubt that maybe we aren't good enough. But when we stop and think about it, every single one of us has self-doubt. The important part is, how do you deal with this doubt and insecurity? Every day we are bombarded with social media showcasing everyone else's highlight reel. The more we can understand that these images and stories of other people's life often do not come with the self-doubt that truly lies within each and every story you scroll through, the more we will become confident and within who we are. Studies have shown that by simply believing in yourself and in others, we are able to do more and be more. So as you strive to be the best version of yourself, never forget to reach back and help others along the way. It's amazing to see what happens to the other person and what happens to you when you begin to live your life in a way that is for others. Legendary coach Bill Walsh, who's one of my favorite football coaches of all time, always said that the most important thing you can say to someone is, "I believe in you." I want to leave you with this. If there's one thing I want you to understand, it's that you're good enough and that there is nothing out there that you can't accomplish when you find your why. So regardless of the doubt you feel at times, believe in yourself and believe in your opportunities. It might not always be easy, but the easy path is not always the best path. And when you find your why and break through that door that was meant for you, make sure that you leave it open for all of those that are coming behind you. Thank you, guys.
Katie, that was wonderful. And I know because we're in this virtual space, you can't see everyone clapping and applauding and smiling, but that was a powerful, powerful message that I think all the girls appreciate. So thank you for that. And I think we can all benefit from the message of the power of our own perspective and believing in ourselves. So we do have some questions for you, if we can get started on that. And there's some fun ones in here. So Amanda would like to know, do you have a different dream job or are you currently in your dream job as a coach?
So there's a couple different ways. If I'm going fantasy world, my dream job is probably, I love music. I wish I was a great singer and musician. But, you know, back to reality, even though I just said we can do anything. And, you know, there also is a reality perspective of it. And I know I'm not a singer, but, you know, my dream job, actually, you know, we always think that sometimes the bright, shiny lights, that's the top, but it's not necessarily what's going to bring you happiness. And recently I started working with women's flag football that is now for the first year, a scholarship opportunity. So girls can actually play flag football and get a scholarship and go to college. And, you know, so building a girls' football program so they don't just have to be a part of it, they can be it. That's kind of my dream.
That's awesome. And, you know, that singing door is just a door that's not open for you.
Absolutely.
Other doors available. So one thing that we really haven't spoken about is your background in kinesiology. And I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about that. And then Nora, who's 13, wants to know how you use that degree with the coach or with the players rather to make them better.
Yeah, that's a good question. So a lot of times I think people, you know, often overlook the importance of degrees and going to school and getting a good education. And for me, kinesiology has been so helpful and just in learning about the movement of the body and helping with the details and the techniques. But also, I had an emphasis in pedagogy in teaching people. And so it's not only, you know, did I learn about the movement of the bodies, how the body works in terms of, you know, being able to help players succeed, but also how to best translate that information and help them to become the best version of themselves.
That's great. Do you have, you know, with that background in kinesiology and that understanding, what would you want young girls to know now about the way they kind of treat their bodies and their own movements that will be of value to them as they grow up?
Know that what you're doing now, you know, there are things out there that might seem like instant gratification, you know, things that all of us do, and we don't think about the impact of the future. And sometimes there's patience involved, there's self-control that's involved, whether it be making sure that you're continuing to work out, that you're eating healthy, that you're taking care of your body, because it's hard to see the results instantly, but your future self will thank your younger self by taking care of yourself and by really allowing, and your brain. I mean, this is everything with your brain as well. The more you can continue to learn and grow, your future self will be happy. And I think we're all too focused sometimes in instant gratification, and we forget about that future self down the road.
That's a great message. Thank you. We have a question from Isabel. She wants to know, was being a professional football coach your first job?
It was not. My very first job was, so my dad, besides coaching women's college basketball, he was also a special education teacher. And so my very first job was working with young girls with special needs. I would go to their house and, you know, whether it be help with a feeding tube, with changing, with it ranged from a whole spectrum. But that was my very first job. And it was ingrained in my mind how important it is to reach out and help people.
That's great. We have a question from Ariana here, and this might be a question on resilience. She wants to know, how many times did you apply to be a coach before you got hired?
Many, many, many times. And actually, you know, there's this idea, we all have probably heard the whole saying, it's not what you know, but who you know. And I'm not saying don't go, now you're like, I'm not going to study, I'm not going to learn anything, because now it's just about who I know. It's, I'm not saying that, but, you know, when I applied to these jobs and I reached out to people, right before I entered the NFL, I had no idea I was going to the NFL at the time, but I knew football was a path for me once I saw Becky Hammon actually coaching in the NBA. That's what, you know, I realized that I could then coach, you know, a sport that I loved. I actually reached out to a female athletic director in the area close to my family. And I saw there was a coaching position open. I didn't even get in for an interview before I got turned down. But it just so happened that about 5 years later, that very same athletic director emailed me and asked if I knew anyone in the area that was interested in coaching the first ever women's flag football team. And I said, I absolutely do. My twin sister, who played USA flag football, at that time, she was a full-time caregiver of my dad, and it changed her life. So actually that rejection, that networking, that's still me reaching out, even though a door slammed in my face, and still being open to reconnecting, led to where my sister's at. And now actually I'm working for that same school that had once turned me down.
Wow. That's a really incredible story. And, you know, your mention of Becky Hammond too, like that representation being there is so empowering. And now you're serving that role for so many young girls today, which is cool. You're passing it along, which is awesome. So we have another question here. When did you first discover your passion for something that isn't considered, let's say, normal for a girl?
I was very, very young. I remember, you know, and all of everyone listening is probably too young to know the movie The Little Giants. If you have not seen that movie, I would encourage you to see it. It's about a youth football team, and there's actually a girl that plays football on that team. And I loved sports. And when I saw that movie, I actually, you know, seeing that representation, even just on a movie, I realized, why can't I do this? And so I think that's what actually sparked my interest in football. And it was this being open-minded to what's around me. And thankfully I had parents that didn't say, no, here you're gonna, you know, play house and whatever stereotypical for the day might've been. When we said for Christmas, we wanted football pads and a football helmet, my dad went to the school that he was coaching at and got football team's old practice gear. It was probably so disgusting, but it was the best Christmas gift any parent could have ever given their child, not only because of it was everything we wanted, but it was showing that they supported us.
Yeah, that's very powerful. And I think, you know, for all the young people that are part of this day today and have been part of Girl Power all week, like whoever signed them up to be part of a program like this, that's that person for them, right? They see the potential in them and they want to open them up to understand all the opportunities that are available. So thanks for sharing.
Absolutely.
So what is the best part of your job? I mean, I think coaching professional football just must be incredibly fun. Is fun the lead adjective or what's the best thing?
It has, you know, moments of fun. It has moments of hardship, but I think the best part is leading people. It's a really good representation of life. If you think about the game of football, it's one of few sports that it's the most diverse sport that I've ever been around. You need people who are big, who are small, who, if you had one person that was exactly the same, you would not be successful. And so, you know, I love this ability to kind of relate football to life and lead people and help people become the best version of themselves. That's always been a passion of mine.
That's wonderful. Do you find working in a male-dominated field that you have to prove yourself more as a woman as being the female in the room, or what does that feel like for you?
I do. And, you know, I wish that that wasn't the case. I remember having a conversation where, you know, I was just reflecting on my experience. And I said, you know, it seems like women in male dominated fields have to prove that they know something before anyone believes them. Whereas a man, they have to do something to prove that they don't know something. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's definitely an obstacle, but it's made me stronger. It's made me work harder and it's made me a better coach.
That's wonderful. I think we have time for maybe one, two more questions here. So we do have a question from Alyssa, and I think we've touched a bit upon this, but really, why are you a coach? What led you to this?
So it was pretty easy transition. I had seen coaching in my family. I had seen teaching in my family, but I was never the one to just think because I saw someone do it, then I was going to do it. But I quickly learned that my passion was around coaching, teaching, or counseling. And I realized that coaching really embodied all three of those things. You're a counselor, you're a teacher, you're a coach. And that was what really led me to that final decision that, yes, this is where I'm meant to be.
That's wonderful. And so Isabel wants to know, we're going to put you on the spot. Do you know how many games you've won?
I've won a lot.
There you go.
And I've all lost of them. A lot as well. I should figure that out though. That's a good question.
future time that we get to get together. Session and have a great afternoon. Thank you for your time as well. We can have a dance party. Nobody wants to see me dance though, I promise. A spark in you just gotta ignite the light and live. Thanks again, ladies. We'll see you later. Shine.